Good afternoon. A woman is fighting for life after a head-on crash in northern New South Wales. Two vehicles collided just before seven last night, killing three people and injuring a two-year-old boy. Sophie Upcroft has the details.
A 34-year-old woman and her two-year-old son are being treated here at Armidale Hospital after a horror crash that killed three others. They were both passengers in a Mazda SUV travelling on the New England Highway a few kilometres north of Armidale when just before seven last night they collided with a Holden Captiva. Both male drivers and the female passenger in the Holden died at the scene. Police say one of the cars had veered onto the wrong side of the road, but they are still investigating which one.
Over the last 36 years, every crash that I've been to, somebody's done something wrong. Someone's made a poor choice that's resulted in tragedy on our roads.
The two-year-old boy only suffered minor injuries. We understand that he was in a car seat, which may well have saved his life. His mum suffered severe chest injuries and is now in a critical but stable condition.
A man has been killed during a major water skiing event on the Victorian New South Wales border. Gillian Lantouris joins us live from Echuca. Jill, this has rocked the community.
It really has, Eliza. It was around 10 o'clock this morning. The annual Southern 80 event was well underway, just an hour into their event, when sadly the team Gasso began competing. One of their water skiers, as they were coming around a bend, it's understood Luke Wentworth, he collided with a tree. Emergency services from both New South Wales and Victoria arrived on the scene, but sadly the man in his 40s couldn't be revived. As you can imagine, this event brings in thousands of spectators and around 900 competitors every year. The event was cancelled abruptly after, but the chief inspector here has summed it up perfectly. Take a listen.
These incidents are an absolute tragedy. They affect all of community, from emergency services to the bloke that owns a fish and chip shop. It's our volunteers that roll out from rural fire service, from SES. This will affect the community for months to come. When everyone goes home, it's an absolute tragedy.
Police will continue to investigate the circumstances around the crash and prepare a report for the coroner. Meanwhile, Luke is being remembered as a gentleman and will be sorely missed by everyone. But this beautiful day here on the border has truly turned to tragedy. Eliza.
It has, Jill. Thank you. More than 15 athletes and staff have been hospitalised after suffering carbon monoxide poisoning at an ice skating rink in Adelaide. The dangerous leak forcing the venue to shut its doors. Gus McDonald reports.
16 people associated with the visiting Melbourne ice hockey team reported difficulty breathing in the early hours of this morning.
It was during last night's game between the Adelaide Rush and Melbourne Ice that players started feeling unwell, showing symptoms of carbon monoxide poisoning, ending up at the Royal Adelaide Hospital's emergency department in the middle of the night.
Typically you get a headache, but you also might feel a little bit tired and a little bit dizzy and sometimes a bit nauseous.
Those in a more serious condition needing to be treated with oxygen therapy. More arriving at hospital this morning.
At about 7 o'clock, there was another seven or eight people attending because of similar symptoms.
The fire service launched a full hazmat response just after 3 a.m. Air testing finding dangerously high levels of carbon monoxide and lower levels of hydrogen cyanide. The likely cause quickly identified.
It looks like it may be the ice resurfacing machine at the moment. That's an internal combustion engine.
It's immediately out of service. We've got a backup machine as well. So that will be put into service.
Fortunately, those who were treated have been released from hospital and are expected to make a full recovery.
All games scheduled today have now been cancelled and the arena will reopen tomorrow.
A community in regional Victoria has come together for a special church service, 1 week since Ballarat mother Samantha Murphy disappeared. As Laura Turner explains, residents are still holding out hope for her safe return.
Well, sadly, there is a sense of hopelessness that is setting into the community here in Buninyong and Ballarat as well. This is day eight and there has not been any significant progress in this investigation into the disappearance of Samantha Murphy. This morning, we witnessed the Anglican Church here in Buninyong hold a service where at the beginning, they actually said quite a lengthy prayer for her, providing some sense of comfort to churchgoers. Let's have a listen to some of that.
Lord God, we pray that Samantha will be found safe and well, and that she will be reunited with her family who love her dearly.
Now, we did speak to some of those churchgoers after the service, and they have admitted that it is getting really tough.
We're all really feeling for them. Our church has been open to anyone who wants to come in and have a bit of quiet time or light a candle for her.
The Ballarat community is very, very strong, and at times like this, that's when it comes to the fore. And, you know, we continue to pray because we know that there is still hope.
In terms of the police investigation, there is no update in terms of the search for Samantha Murphy today. Police are still reiterating, though, that they need any dash cam or CCTV from people living in the area. They need them to hand it in, whether they think it's useful or not, and they will sift through that and find out as to whether there are things they need to be looking at. Please come forward and hand it in to police. We do understand, too, that they will be back out in the bush sometime this week searching for Samantha Murphy, looking into what progress they can make with her mobile phone and her watch that she was wearing while she was running on the day as well. What they can gain from information from data that came from those two devices, hoping that it gives her family some answers.
High-profile Melbourne entrepreneur and philanthropist Harold Mitchell has died after suffering complications following recent knee surgery. The 81-year-old advertising guru founded Australia's largest media and communications group, Mitchell & Partners. His career spanned more than 45 years, raising millions of dollars for health, education and arts projects through his foundation. He is survived by his two children. With the money from the government's tax cuts now due in our pay from July, a new political fight is opening up on the wider issue. Here's political editor Charles Croucher.
With the coalition supporting the government's change to stage three tax cuts, tax has become the talk of the town. Now, privately, both sides acknowledge there is an over-reliance on income tax, that is, taxing people as they earn when they go about their daily jobs. Instead, there's now talk of what can change, how to lower the need and lower the burden on people's finances during this cost of living crisis. So far, not so much ruling things in as ruling things out.
Raising the GST in the middle of a cost of living crisis is not something that a Liberals can support.
The coalition has ruled out changes to the GST. Labor says there's no intention to change how housing is taxed, that is, negative gearing or capital gains taxes.
There's this focus, unfortunately, on what we're not proposing, when I would rather focus on what we are proposing, because it will make a bit of a difference to the people who are facing these cost of living pressures.
This is a long-term problem for both sides of Parliament. It will be a medium-term issue at the election. In the meantime, everyone will be waiting months for those tax cuts, which begin in July.